very interesting. And she said that how a lot of patients come thinking that it's about IVF, and that is not necessarily true. Can you lend some perspective on that?
There are so many factors. Obviously, it can be a female factor. It can be a non-release of the egg, especially if a woman has polycystic ovaries. It can be a male factor. There are many, many reasons for IVF. It affects people physically and emotionally and psychologically. So there's many layers in which we also have to deal with to help couples through the process. It is a medical procedure, but unfortunately it's a medical procedure that doesn't always work. So you have to be there to support them in every aspect of their life, in their emotional well-being, in their success, in their failure, in their decision to go and do it and spend all this money and go to Barbados for the highest success rate. But at the end of the day, you know, it's all about individualized care and looking at every case individually. You know, I just spoke with a woman who said, you know, my case is very complicated. I've got a lot of problems. And she's had a myomectomy and she's got polycystic ovaries. She's got blocked tubes. And, you know, it's not just simply, I can't get pregnant, I need IVF. Ultimately, they can't get pregnant, they need IVF. But each person comes with a whole host of different medical issues behind it, you know.
How important is the role of really listening? So before you even get into the clinical stages, what is the role of listening to the patient? You mentioned individualized care.
Well, look, at the end of the day, you know, they've been trying anywhere between 2 and 12 and 16 years, and they may or may not have told somebody, their friend, maybe their mum, maybe their sister, but it's such a... It's so hard for them because it affects every part of their life. It affects, you know, their friends are having babies, their sister's having a baby, their cousin's having a baby, they're going to baby showers, they're going to this, they're going to that. They walk down the street, they can never get away from it. So there's all of this negative emotion that's built up, and, you know, you've got to try and get them to talk about it because, as we all know, negative emotion is very damaging. And if you come into an IVF cycle full of this negative emotion and this negativity, it can only decrease your success rates. And, you know, I just spoke to a woman and she said, well, do I have to go to Barbados for the IVF? And I'm like, no, you can do all the monitoring and all the screening and everything here, but you have to come to Barbados for 5 to 7 days. And that's not just to avail of the best laboratory and the best service that you can get, but it's also at a really, really crucially emotional time where you are having an egg collection, you're having an embryo transfer, that you're actually just looking after yourself. You're not on the road trying, taking a call from your boss, your mum's on the phone, you're trying to problem solve, you're sitting in traffic, because as stress levels go up, pregnancy rates go down. And when they're in Barbados, I mean, literally the first day they come in, they're all, yes, yes, we're here for our scan. And by the time you see them 2 days later, they're completely different people. They're relaxed, they're happy, and it has to benefit them. It has to, because they actually, for the first time, have a chance to stop and just look after themselves at a really crucial time of the treatment cycle.
Could you make a deeper, you mentioned about the stress levels and pregnancy levels going down. Could you make a deeper connection between, because I know one of the key things that define you is the stress-free environment. So could you make that connection between stress and the ability to get pregnant?
Well, they've done a lot of studies. The problem is stress is very hard to monitor, because what might be stressful for me wouldn't be stressful for you at all. So when you give somebody a scale of 0 to 10 of stress for the exact same situation, you and I could monitor it, score it completely different. So it's hard to medically quantify. However, what they have done, and they've shown in studies over and over again, when they look at the stress levels for people going through IVF, and the higher stress level couples or women undergoing IVF have got a lower egg number, a lower fertilization rate. So in other words, stress affects your cells, and eggs at the end of the day are cells, and so is sperm. And so you get a lower egg number, you get a lower fertilization number, which ultimately results in a lower pregnancy rate, not just because your body is, you're getting lower egg numbers and lower fertilization numbers, but remember that pregnancy is a stress on the body, okay? And your fundamental right, if you like, as a human being, is to preserve your own life. So if your body is under stress, and next thing an embryo is trying to implant, your body's like, no, I can't deal with that, I'm stressed enough, and it'll push it away. It has to, because your self-preservation will always win out. And so as your stress levels rise, your pregnancy rates have to drop, because your body isn't willing to accept an additional stress on what it is already feeling.